Our program today is a bit different. You've heard me mention before that my family and I have our devotions together each day by reading God's Word, engaging in a little question and answer session, and then having a time of prayer. Well, on Christmas Day, we do the same thing, but we read the Christmas story. And I'd like to invite you to join us today. I'm here in the studio with my wife, Linda.
Hello.
My daughter, Tina, who's 18.
Hi.
And my daughter, Tiffany, who's 17.
Hi.
Won't you read along with us out of Luke 2 and just pretend that you're here in the studio enjoying a Kroll family Christmas? I'm going to read the story today out of the King James Version of the Bible, because that's the version that so many recognize when they hear the Christmas story. Maybe you'd like to follow along in your own Bible and in whatever version you like. I'll read a couple of verses and then we'll stop to comment on them, okay? Everyone ready?
Mm-hmm.
Luke 2. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. Now let's stop there for a moment. I always find it helpful if I can place these biblical events in the calendar of history. Now, these verses say that a decree went out during the reign of Caesar Augustus. Do any of you know when that was?
Well, since it was the birth of Jesus, it must have been at the beginning of the first century.
Yes, that's right. That was too easy. Let me ask it another way. When did this take place in relation to, say, Julius Caesar? Did Caesar Augustus live after Julius Caesar or before him? Tina?
After Julius Caesar.
Right. How do you know?
Lucky guess.
That's what I thought. But you are right. Julius Caesar died in 44 B.C., and all the emperors of Rome, from Augustus to Hadrian, took his name as a title of respect. We refer to the Caesars of Rome in the same way we refer to the pharaohs of Egypt, or the kings of England. All these are titles.
That means Jesus lived only a few years after Julius Caesar.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, Augustus, the man mentioned here in verse 1, was the grandnephew of Julius Caesar. His real name was Octavian, but he changed it to Caesar Augustus when he became emperor in 27 B.C.
I have a question. Why did they go to their own city to be taxed? Couldn't they just pay their taxes where they lived?
A good question, Tiffany. Actually, this appears to be more than a taxation. It was really a registration of all the people with a view to taxation. Today, we would call this a what?
A census.
Right, a census. So, in order to enroll everyone in this census, they had to return to the central city of their tribe, or the place of their birth. For Mary and Joseph, that was David's city, Bethlehem. So to answer your question, Tiff, if it had just been a collection of taxes, they could have done that in Nazareth. But it was much more. Well, can we move on?
Mm-hmm.
Let's read the next couple of verses. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. Now, I have a question. It says Joseph went up from Galilee into Judea, but Judea is south of Galilee. Wouldn't it make more sense to say down from Galilee into Judea? Tina?
This time I do know the answer. The verse says up rather than down because it's talking about elevation and not direction.
That's right. Judea was basically in the mountains of Israel, and Galilee was in a northern valley that raised slowly to a mountainous region. Nazareth would have been considerably lower in elevation than Bethlehem, and thus up is the right word. I guess you girls have an advantage here because both of you have traveled to Israel with Mom and me. Not everyone would know why you go up when you go down on the map. Very good.
Maybe you should explain what the word espoused means in verse 5.
Well, sure. Why don't you go ahead?
Well, it's obvious that by this time Mary and Joseph were married. Espoused must mean more than engaged, because Joseph would not have allowed Jesus to be born without a legal father.
Yeah, that's correct. There was a point at which they were just engaged. But remember, Matthew says that after an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph and told him it was okay to marry Mary, That sounds a little funny, doesn't it? To take Mary to be his wife. Matthew 1, 24 and 25 says, Joseph took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus.
So Mary and Joseph were married at this time, but there was no physical union between them until after Jesus was born. What amazes me is that Mary could stand that trip of about 90 miles in the last days of her pregnancy. As a mother, I don't envy her one bit.
Well, I've never been a mother, but it must have been some trip. Look at verse 6. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Can anyone tell me what swaddling clothes are?
Are those baby clothes, like a baby's blanket?
Well, not exactly, but you're on the right track, Tiffany. Swaddling clothes were bands of cloth. Ordinarily, in the days of Jesus, a newborn baby would be placed diagonally on a square piece of cloth, which was folded over the infant. These swaddling bands of cloth were wrapped around the baby to keep him warm, keep the baby from harm, from hitting something with kicking feet or swinging arms. So Jesus must have been wrapped tightly and looked a lot like a baby in a hospital nursery today.
You know, when you girls were born, Daddy and I brought you home from the hospital to a nice room. We put you in a baby bed with a bumper pad so you wouldn't bump your head. But all Mary had to lay Jesus in was a manger.
A lot of people confuse a manger with a stable.
Yes, that's right, Tina. The stable was the area where Jesus was born, the place where they kept sheep and donkeys. The manger, where they laid the baby Jesus, was the trough where animals were fed.
I remember seeing a manger like that in Back to the Bible's video, Sandals in the Sand. It was just about the size of a baby's bed, but it certainly didn't look comfortable.
No, I'm sure it wasn't. It was stone, and it was hard. But Mary would have made her baby as comfortable as she could. Well, let's read on in the story. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
Why does everyone say that the angel sang that night? Both verse 10 and verse 13 say the angel spoke these words.
Yes, you're right, Tiffany. It doesn't say they sang. We probably get that from Charles Wesley's great hymn, Hark, the Herald Angels Sing. But that doesn't mean they couldn't have sung. After all, this was the greatest news to greet mankind since the fall of Adam and Eve in the garden. These angels had plenty to sing about. Even though Jesus was not their Savior, he's our Savior.
If swaddling clothes were a common way to wrap a newborn baby, then the sign the shepherds were to look for must have been that Jesus was in a manger.
Oh, I think you're right, Tina. Who would have ever thought that the King of Kings, the Lord God from heaven, the long-awaited Messiah, would be found as a baby, let alone a baby laid in a stone trough used to feed lowly animals? Well, as soon as these shepherds got the good word, notice what they did. Verse 15. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste, and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things, and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. You know, when these shepherds saw the baby Jesus lying in the manger, That was a dead giveaway. They were in the right place.
I noticed they didn't keep their discovery a secret very well. It looks like they told everyone they could about the birth of the baby.
I think you're right. They blabbered this good news to everyone they saw. And in the process, they glorified and praised God for all that happened that first Christmas night.
Well, there was one person who didn't tell anyone.
Who was that?
Mary. Verse 19 says she kept all these things and pondered them in her heart.
What do you think that means, Linda?
Well, as a mother, I know what I would have thought about. I'd wonder what was going to become of my baby. How would people accept him? Since the Holy Spirit was Jesus' father and not Joseph, how would Joseph accept him? I'd wonder if all the prophecies about the Messiah could really be about my baby. Mostly, I'd wonder how I was going to stand the trip back to Nazareth.
Well, as it turned out, Mary and Joseph didn't go right back to Nazareth. There's a lot to think about here, isn't there? Tina, what one thing stands out in your mind about this story?
Well, after reading the story over and over, it seems to me that God chooses the lower classes of people to reveal this sort of thing to.
That's a good observation. Remember, Paul says in 1 Corinthians, God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. Tiffany, what strikes you most about this story?
Well, looking at verse 14, I noticed that Christ's arrival brought something to both worlds. It brought glory to God in heaven, and it brought peace and goodwill to earth.
Yes, that's true. In fact, it's always true that whatever brings glory to God brings good to us.
I like the fact that humble shepherds were chosen to be the first to see the Christ child and to tell others.
I suppose there's a message in there for all of us. God loved this world so much that he sent his son as a sinless baby. He sent Jesus to the most meager surroundings, so even the most humble people could have a relationship with him. And when Jesus grew up and was crucified on Calvary's cross, he hung between two common criminals. God was always doing something like that. Every incident in Jesus' life, from the cradle to the cross, showed just how much he loved us. This Christmas, folks, I'm thankful for my family. I'm thankful for the ministry of Back to the Bible. But more than anything else, I'm thankful that God loved me enough to use a stable instead of a hotel, to tell the good news first to shepherds instead of kings. This is a great Christmas and a great Christmas story because we serve a great God. Let's thank him together. Our Father, we praise your holy name for loving us when there was nothing to love. We thank you for sending your Son to become a man, a human being, a humble servant. Thank you for stars, for stables, for swaddling clothes, and for shepherds. But most of all, Father, thank you for our Savior. May this Christmas season indeed bring peace to the world through the Prince of Peace, your Son, our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen.
You are now at the end of this series of messages entitled, I Hope You Enjoyed These Two Messages by Dr. Kroll and His Family.
Thank you for listening to Back to the Bible. Join us again tomorrow. God bless you.